Hello, in the sequence of the last video about gravitation and the geometric law of motion, I was talking about Einstein's gravitation. And I have to notice something. When I say that, or I mean, I'm not, I cannot be sure of this. It's just we are talking about the issue. Therefore, I make my spirit as free as to question everything. And in my point of view, this aspect of Einstein contraction and dilatation of time is something that we should also think again, in my opinion. But this video is not to discuss this issue, of course. We will talk about geometric law of motion, but I use the opportunity to clarify a bit my what I said in the last video. And let us suppose this. Let's suppose that we have this person here in a kind of cabin or a train, for example. Another interesting remark is that imagine that we are in a train and the train is with a certain velocity and there's a person which is seated on a train. So in the perspective of the person that is outside of the train, this person which is seated, simply seated in the train, making no force, no action, no energy, it's capable of running from one place to the other in the space very fast. Even we could imagine that we say, or we may say, that someone that start to run 100 meters mark, the 100 meter mark inside the train, it will be so fast that in fact it's not real. It seems to be fast, but it's not fast, that person. I mean, if you run inside of train, you need the same energy to make a certain distance as you need if you would be stopped. So you cannot attribute to the person, to the runner, you cannot attribute to it the energy that takes him from one place to the other. That energy is contained, is the energy of the container which is moving. In light, I think it should be wondered about this also. When we have some light inside of a thing, and if we move this thing, we are not, because of this, we are not giving energy to this light, or I mean, we are not giving more power to this line, or more velocity to this line, more capability to this line of running through the space. It's wrong. This light will always run at the velocity of light, which is a constant. And so I think it's this kind of ambiguity that stays since long time in this impregnating this theory, and I think one should in fact to look at it without problems, without, I mean, without taboos, and just try to understand better, or at least to clarify such ambiguity. And so I will propose, or something that could be done, sorry, would be to analyze a situation like this. Imagine that this person is at rest and he fires the laser beam. The laser beam has, imagine, for these calculations to be easier, imagine that this laser beam would be of a very of a lambda wavelength, which is precisely this distance. So the laser beam would do one wavelength from the source to the A point, which is this point here. And now let us imagine that this cabin is falling at velocity v. And what happens is that, my opinion, the laser beam will do the same one wavelength from the point here to A. And so, for an observer out of the system, it will see this observer, it will apparently see that the space where the beam was moving was in fact longer than this. Of course it is, but the velocity doesn't have to be different, because we know that the velocity is lambda times f of an electromagnetic wave. The lambda times f, so the wavelength times frequency, linear frequency, is equal c. So if I just the if the lambda is bigger then the frequency is lower, and then from here to here the time of propagation, I mean the velocity of propagation, must be c. But the impression, the only thing, is that this observer outside feels the impression that this color of this laser is going to the red, so it's a red shift, because the lambda is bigger than this one, is longer than this one. So the only impression is that, my point of view, this person here inside of cabin will see the laser beam going till the point A, the same as if it would be stopped, the cabin. And the outside one only have the impression of dilatation of space, but in fact it is just the and so it deduces that the velocity must be higher, but the velocity is not necessary to be higher, because it's just the wavelength must be higher, but there is this relation in the wavelength, so the frequency is going to be lower, and so this will see simply a red shift. And what is this red shift? It's very easy to calculate now with this diagram. I know that lambda 1 squared, it is lambda 0 squared times v delta t squared. And I know that this delta t, it's 1 over f0, because it's measured from him, it's 1 over f0. And so if I substitute this, I get to the relation lambda 1 minus lambda 0 squared over lambda 0 squared equal v squared over c squared, which means a redshift. So, as we see, it must, it's, there's an, I have an impression that, in effect, one thing is redshift and dilatation of lambda, and but in effect the product of lambda with the frequency, it's constant, so velocity is constant. I don't see here case of time contraction, and I don't know. Anyway, let us continue to this. And so the ambiguity of this theory, it's for me a bit stays. I cannot forget this ambiguity. All right, so now let's talk about gravitation and the geometric law of motion. The geometric law of motion is something that I've been working on, and it's a concept of motion in the way of a geometrical algebra, generalization of Newton's second law. So herein I will be it will be presenting the particular case of gravitation. So geometric law of motion, as I call it, it's something that is more general than any field. So it can be applied, or would be applied if it is true, of course, because this this is just some divagations in physics. But it could be applied to anything, like the second law of Newton, but in more general terms. And what I my way of looking at this is that we can look at the system of motion in general as being expressed in two parameters. One is a scalar, which is linear action, and the other one is an angular vector. So this a vector and this angular action, which is angular momentum. Notice that also the gyro gravitation model is a more specific representation for gravitation, which includes both radial and the angular motion of fields. So if you have curiosity, Google gyro gravitation to learn a bit more about that. Notice also this interesting aspect is that I can define this way the state of a system, no matter what the system is, but the safe state of the system, it's a kind of quaternion state or quaternionic state. Quaternion, it's as I try to say, it's something invented by Hamilton, and it's very powerful. And so it's the sum, I could say, the sum of a scalar with a vector, and is related to geometric law of algebra. I mean, geometrical algebra. So, what happens in this geometrical law of motion is that the modifier of a state, what I say, the modifier of a state, which I use this symbol here to denote quaternion, the modifier of a state, it's simply the derivative of time of the state. So, it is the derivative of time in order to time of the action, which is energy, and is the derivative of time of angular momentum, which is torque, and so radial energy implicitly. And so I can say that this modifier of the system, what modifies the system, the state of the system, is something like this, is this expression, and so it is like this. And so we can even say that in terms of quaternions, we say that modifier of a system, it's the derivative of time of the state of the system. So look at this as a kind of generalized second law, which includes translations and rotations. So translation is due to this term, and rotation is due to this term here of the term related to L. So I can also write this in another way, is that if I understand that S equals the projection of the quantity of motion, the linear momentum, into the position vector, then and L is the angular momentum, R vectorial MP, then I can also attribute or assign to S, I mean, where is it here? This, sorry, I can assign this term R times F, which is the energy, or I mean the work done on the system in the direction of R. So it's a radial work, which is obviously the derivative of in order to time of the action, which is related to energy, of course. And the other term here, it is the torque. It's r factorial f. So I make this inequality, and so I can even, this is a way of writing things. If I use quaternions, I can put here, just is another algebra, from here is, and here is another way of representing. So it's scalar plus a vector, it's a derivative of time, scalar plus a vector. So this is quaternionic form. It's more compacted using geometric algebra product. And using geometric algebra product, I can even write this, all this thing in this form. And if you see, if one sees, this form is precisely, is very similar to the generalization of Newton's second law. If I would divide this expression by R, then I would have f equal derivative of time of mv. So it's going on that direction. But I can also express all this in terms of matrix way. But a simple notation that I use very much is this one. It's separating the two terms, the term of scalar and the term of vector, and separate the two by two equations. And we could say that we could write the equation of the like this. And in general, we could write the equation like this. So this equal, because now I'm derivating this part by parts. So it's derivative of r times this, and times this, and this is the same. So this external force, therefore, as we can see from here, is present, and this what changes the state of the system. So this is the general condition. But for example, in a system, natural system of gravity, for example, we don't have to be external forces. We can count, for example, imagine with gravitation and with angular momentum. So we imagine the things going around the planet just due to gravitation, and there is another law of conservation, which is angular momentum. In that case, if there's no external force acting upon the planets other than the gravitation itself, internal gravitation itself, we can say that the external forces are null, and so we have a situation like this, which is a stationary regime, of course. And this is the case of natural gravitation. And what can I say about that? We can see now that if we imagine a mass, big mass as M here, which is responsible for creating of a gravitational field, and there's an observer here also, when do we have another mass M there with velocity V, and we know that in this place there's an acceleration due to the gravitational field, which we'll call G. And G will be dependent on R, of course, on distance to field. And let us assume two perpendicular directions, the direction of R, which is the parallel direction, and the perpendicular to R, which is this one. So the scalar component. Let's talk now, or let's analyze now the scalar component here of the geometrical law of motion. So this one. This scalar component tells us that the derivative of r in order to time, which is four long r's, it is and slow velocities, we can consider this precisely the same as the velocity. And so, here, plus r scalar m dv dt, it is, we can, in this case, we can consider that acceleration present, internal acceleration internal to the system present, is g of r. And so we can make say this, that for low velocities and low large radius, we can say that mv squared plus dx equals zero. Notice the interesting thing is this is another way of looking at kinetic energy, of course, in the system. And this is another way of saying that kinetic energy plus the potential energy on that point must be equal to zero. And so I can say that in general we can talk about a relation between these two things like this. Notice something is that of course we have to put here minus because of g, this vector here is minus, but we'll talk about that later. And what about the vectorial component? The vectorial component says to us that the derivative of r in order to time, which is in the same circumstances, it's also we can talk it, or we can consider it phi vectorial mv plus this vectorial ma, which this is the gravitational field equals zero. Of course, this v vectorial v is zero, and so this is just reduced to r vectorial mg equals zero, and so this is zero when r equals zero, center of gravitation here, or we have the system, the gravitation in the observer there. Second, where g of r equals zero, the mass is free at infinitum. This is also valid. And the normal case, if r different zero and g different zero, this implies something very important, is that g must be parallel to r. And it's true. It is true. So there's a g here and it is parallel to r. This also means that the angular momentum is conserved, it's fixed momentum. So what can we say about these two things? The first thing, in the first case, we can deduce that this is true. I already put here minus because of the sign, and this g is opposite to r. And we can also say that the g is parallel to r. Okay, this is an information, a good information, but we don't use it, don't need to use it now. We can use just this one to say that cutting the masses, it's something independent on the mass, it's v squared minus r times g key of r equals zero. And from here, of course, we get very simple to this equation here. And anyone will notice that this equation is the orbiting velocity for stationary orbits. So you see that by this reasoning we can get directly to the velocity needed to a stationary orbit, that is the stationary system. This expression is valid for any sort of function g of r, of course, and so it's it's interesting because if I'm in a system that g of r is dependent on one of r cubic, for example, I can even introduce it here and see what happens. But let us assume it is a Newtonian thing, Newtonian gravitation. So g of r is equals g times m over r square, and this implies, of course, this velocity of orbital velocities must be this as expected. So it's a way of representing things, but it seems interesting. Let us analyze a limit case. For example, v squared equal Let us put this again. V square equal r times g. It means that r, if I focus on r, is v square over g, so equals this, and so r equals gm over v squared. And now let's make us a question. Try to relate the velocity of light, the fastest velocity that we, the speed that we may admit, and let us insert it in here on this thing. Let us question ourselves. Which is the minimum orbital radius acceptable in a gravitational system? Considering that v maximum, the velocity maximum of orbiting, must be c, speed of light. It's very simple. This r minimum equals minus gm over c squared. So this is the gravitational mass, this is the Newton's gravitation, and this is speed of light squared. And if you make this calculation, we will see that for the mass of our Sun, it would be 1.3 kilometer. So we can imagine that there is, or there must be, some kind, or we may expect some kind of, in a system of gravitation, we may expect that there is a point here, a radius here, which is the minimum radius where the velocity of the particles go or reach the velocity of light, and so it's a radius below that. It's not possible. What is possible? For radius inferior of this, we may not expect any kind of matter orbiting. We may expect, particles, microparticles or atomic particles, nuclear particles, a case of mix of all the things, electrons, light, energy, electromagnetic things, and here, but not matter, or the less matter the possible, because it's not a place to be there matter. And if we reason like this, we can see that looking to all this system, which tends to be a planar system with an angular momentum L, and if we look from the side, something like this, what means is that in this point here, or around this zone, the central zone, we have in fact a wall where there's no mass in principle, or the mass that is there may be only electrons and things that can be accelerated to velocities near velocity of light. But something interesting to notice is that in this, all this gravitational system, maybe in the center the gravitation is null, but if we move to up a bit laterally in the plane, in the direction perpendicular to the plane of rotation of all the system, if we move a bit, we will feel a very big gravitational force or acceleration into sending us again to the equilibrium, this point. And if we get some velocity here, we surpass the point and go to the other side. And then we are attracted again and go to up. And then we are attracted again and go to down. And notice that this is a synchronized, this may be synchronized. And all the particles and the energy that start to jump or enter this region must be oscillating and start to be oscillating in phase, or tending to be in phase. And what may happen is that this start to be like a transformed in a kind of oscillator, resonant oscillator of matter, I mean of particles and energy. And this is like a maser, what one may call a maser. And of course this can reach certain situations of amplification that a beam of energy can of particles or something can be emitted sometimes when the amplification is too high and not supportable anymore around this system. So is this a mechanism of a black hole? Well, I don't know. What is interesting is to understand that there must be other ways of looking at the gravitation and understanding that what one simply call black holes, which are things coming out from our imagination just to fulfill an incomplete thing, which is things like dark energy and so on. We could perhaps study the things and reasoning and thinking on other directions. For example, one of that directions could be to do these things that I'm doing here, for example, in order to reach a theory which is more clarified, more clear about those things. To finalize, I would just say this, is that interesting this is also that if L is constant, we will see that the as the speed increases near the center, the angular momentum decreases, so it will be less here, angular momentum, I expect here. It's a zone of, notice, so here is very high angular momentum, okay, but then there's very low angular momentum inside here, and so all the particles of or energy that will be oscillating there just can oscillate in principle in the direction of this zeta direction, and so L minimum would be I was calculating for our gravitational system, and the L minimum is about this value. So also one expects that at black hole, at the black hole, I call this between commas, mass is transforming into light and the soup of elementary particles which enter the eye of the gravitational maser and will be made to oscillate along L direction, emitting bursts of energy to the outside world sometimes. This is a resonant oscillator. Would this be an interesting thing or not? I don't know. My job is to think openly and about physics, and I hope this helps something and someone to get the truth of all this motion that we see around us. Thank you very much.